All right, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to lecture 23 of Quantum Mechanics 1. In the previous lecture, I talked about, we've been talking about time evolution of quantum states. And I explained that there are two different pictures, Schrodinger picture and Heisenberg picture. There's a third picture, which is called the interaction picture, which is somewhat of a hybrid of the two. So if time permits, and I think it's necessary, I'll talk about it at some point. So we saw that in the Schrodinger picture, it is the states that change with time. In the Heisenberg picture, it is the operator. But both of them give the same result at the end, which is the expectation values are the same. And then we looked at a more non-trivial example of a evolution of a wave packet, right? Which is this Gaussian wave packet. And again, I have given you these exercises, which are part of homework 2. And homework 2 will be due sometime next week. So please start work on that. And so as you see, there's an exercise here, which is for you to work out the details of how you go from this integral of the Gaussian state. This integral of the Gaussian state to you make a certain suitable change of variables. After making the change of variables, you can perform the integration, and the integration gives you an explicit expression for psi of x. From this, you can obtain the probability density. The probability density has the shape of a time-dependent Gaussian. Okay, one second. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
All right. I'm having some network problems here, so. Zoom does not appear to be behaving very well. Okay, so we end up with this expression for the probability density. And this is still a Gaussian because it has this general form. But now both the variance, which is measured by this parameter alpha, and the center of the Gaussian, which is measured by the location of, so this should, if you write this as x minus x naught, x is the x naught would be the center of the Gaussian. So I should do that. Okay. Write it like this, x minus x naught squared over alpha squared. So x naught is the location of the center of the Gaussian, and alpha is a measure of the width. The center is moving with some velocity v, and the wave packet keeps spreading out in time. Okay, but it remains a Gaussian, which in particular, which means that so this is again part of the exercise, calculate delta x, delta p, and then show that delta x times delta p is equal to h bar by 2. So this is very important because this is an equality, right? Not an inequality. So it's the statement that a wave packet of this form, which has this shape, is what is known as a minimum uncertainty state. Okay, so because the uncertainty principle is an inequality, right? Delta x times delta p is greater than or equal to h bar by 2. So this saturates that inequality, the lower bound, right? Okay, so today, let me talk about a little bit about Arnold and Fest theorem, and after that, I'll start talking about quantum harmonic oscillators. So Arnold and Fest theorem is a state. The Arnold and Fest theorem is a statement about the relationship or about the classical behavior of quantum systems. Okay. So what does right now, when I say classical behavior of quantum systems, I don't mean that, you know, quantum systems are completely classical, but they have a certain limit in which, in that limit, you should recover Newton's laws of motion, right? And any theory of physics should satisfy a requirement which I refer to as the principle of backwards compatibility. Okay, what is the meaning of backwards compatibility? In the context of software, backwards, this is a term that is used in the software industry, right? What it means is that, let's say you get a new version of your favorite word processing software, document processing software, but it so happens that it cannot read the documents created by the previous version, right? So that is not backwards compatible, right? And such a software would not be very useful for most people. Similarly, a theory which is backwards compatible is something that matches with the pre-existing theory in a certain domain, right? So we have a certain domain here, right? Where theory one, which is our old theory, is valid, let's say. And then we have a domain where we have theory two, which is the new theory, let's say, right? So for instance, theory one, if you talk about special relativity, here V is much less than C, here V is approximately equal to C, then there should be some region some overlap, right, where your physics can be described by the results of theory one plus some corrections, right, plus some small corrections, right? Because as you imagine you going in this direction, right, going into theory one, going to smaller and smaller velocities, Newton's law should become more and more accurate, right? So it should be possible to describe the motion of a particle as Newton's laws plus some small correction. When you go to large velocities, of course, you will have to start using a completely relativistic description, right? A similar thing holds true, let's say, for quantum mechanics and classical mechanics. So for relativity, the relevant parameter is the typical speed of motion, right? For quantum mechanics, right, the relevant parameter is h bar. So h bar is zero, and here we will say h bar is approximately one. Now you might say, well, I know h bar is not one, it's 6.63 times 10 to the minus 34, but that's only in a particular system of units, right? So when I say h bar is one, that means what I mean is h bar is large, and here it's very small, right? In the same way that here you can say that V by C is much less than one, and here I can say that V by C is somewhat equal to one, right? So similarly, you can define a dimensionless h bar, which is very small in the classical domain, and which is large meaning it is comparable to one in the quantum domain. And then if one more person unmutes himself without a reason, I will turn off the permission to unmute yourself at all. Okay, so please don't do that anymore. Thank you. So Ehrenfest theorem tells us that quantum mechanics is backwards compatible with classical mechanics. And let's see how that comes about, okay? So again, we look at our free particle plus some potential term. Okay. So the Hamiltonian for this is p squared by 2m plus v of x, right? So this is your free particle. This is your potential, right? And from this, we obtain equations of motion, right? So what are the equations of motion? We have x dot is equal to dh by dp, and p dot is equal to minus dh by dx, right? These are Hamilton's equations. Right. You can also obtain these equations from by looking at the Poisson bracket of the Hamiltonian with some function. So what was that? I had that expression somewhere here. Don't seem to find it. So let me just write it down. So these equations are equivalent to the statement that if you have some function on your phase space, then the Poisson bracket of that function with your Hamiltonian, right? So this is a function of your phase space coordinates, is equal to the time derivative of that function. Okay. Now, so when you apply these equations to this expression here, what do we get? We get, and this again, I should be careful, is df by dt, the total time derivative. So dx by dt is equal to dh dp, right? And since the potential doesn't depend on the momentum, I just get p by 2m, right? If you want, you can put a vector on this. What about the rate of change of momentum? Is minus dh by dx, right? Now, the kinetic term doesn't depend on the position, so the derivative will only act on the potential term. And what is this? This is just the gradient of the negative gradient of the potential, right? So these are Newton's equations of motion, right? It basically tells you that F is equal to ma, right? Or more appropriately, F is equal to dp dt. So this is your force, right? This is your external force. Now, so the thing is that in quantum mechanics, so this is all classical mechanics, right? In quantum mechanics, you don't have a phase space, right? Why don't you have a phase space? Can somebody tell me really quickly? Okay, that's not fast enough. And the reason for that is because you have your position and momentum operators, and these operators don't commute. And since they don't commute, we cannot measure position and momenta simultaneously, right? So it doesn't make sense to talk about functions of position and momenta. Okay. Right. So you can ask, well, then in what sense, is there any sense in which quantum mechanics contains something like this, right? Something which looks like Newton's equations of motion, right? And again, by this principle of backwards compatibility, you would hope that that is the case, that there is something present, right? So instead, in quantum mechanics, we don't have a number P, right? So in classical mechanics, I have a number or a set of numbers P, and I can ask what is the time derivative of these numbers. But in quantum mechanics, what do I have? I have an operator P hat, right? So what I want is to ask, what is the time derivative of an operator, right? And how do I answer this question? I can answer this question by going to the Heisenberg picture, right? Because in the Heisenberg picture, my operators become time dependent, right? And the time dependence is given by something like this. And then we have the Heisenberg equation of motion, which we derived. Which is this statement, right? The commutator of, so the time derivative of any operator is given by the commutator of that operator with the Hamiltonian. Right, so this is equivalent to, this is the statement for classical mechanics, right? This is how you calculate the time dependence of any function on the phase space. So the Heisenberg equation of motion tells you that any operator the time dependence of an any operator. Again, is that a minus or a plus? For the life of me, I can never remember the minus. So maybe there should be a minus sign here also. Minus h bar, and then this is the time derivative. Okay, and so now I can ask, well, what is the time derivative of my momentum operator? The time derivative of momentum operator minus h bar times the time derivative is going to be commutator of h with p, which means commutator of p square by 2m plus vx with p, right? And now we know that if you take the commutator of any function of any operator with any function of that operator, it's zero, right? And so this becomes the commutator of this potential term with the momentum operator, right? And so I can write dp by dt. I can take the I on the other side. So if I multiply both sides by I get a plus sign here, and I get I over here. And then I can write this as minus I by h bar. And then switch the two arguments in the commutator, okay? Now, this is something that we have seen before, right? I think I gave this to you as a problem in your mid-sem, right? Which is that if you take the commutator of the momentum with any function of the position, right? What you get is minus I h bar df by dp. And if you take the commutator of the position with any function of the momentum, you get I h bar, the derivative of this operator with respect to, with respect to the moment. Okay. So if I use this expression over here, if I use this expression, right, what do I find? I get minus dvd. Okay. Now, so let me write this down again. I have dp by dt minus dvx by dx. And I'll put all of that in a box because it's a very important and a very nice result. Right? Now, so if you look at what this result is telling you, right? It is relating the time evolution of these operators, right? So here P and X are operators, right? Now what you can do is you can take the expectation value of both sides. So if you take the expectation value of the RHS, you can write it in this way. Okay, and any other exercises for you along the way? Not yet. Right? And so the statement becomes that the time derivative of the expectation value of the momentum operator is equal to negative of the expectation value of the gradient of the potential as an operator, right? An operator function, an operator valued function of X. And so this equation is one of the most important results in quantum mechanics. And it is, it goes by the name of Eulenfest's theorem, which is named after Paul Eulenfest, who was one of the great physicists of the early 20th century. He played an instrumental role in the development of quantum mechanics, but he also had somewhat of a tragic story. Probably in today's language, we would say that he was suffering from depression, and that led him to take his own life. He was also one of Einstein's closest friends. So his loss was a big, was felt very deeply by Einstein. So anyways, this is the statement that expectation values of the momentum operator behave in the same way that we would expect them to behave from classical mechanics. Right? And now the thing is that, see, this expectation value doesn't depend on whether you use the Heisenberg picture or the Schrodinger picture, right? So this statement is true in both pictures, right? Another aspect of this is that there is no H bar, right? In this expression, H bar is not there. So we have our correspondence with classical mechanics, right? So we will apply this, we will apply Eulenfest's theorem when we talk about the quantum harmonic oscillator, which is the next topic. Okay, so the simple harmonic oscillator. So let's do that. Are there any questions at this point? Please ask. Okay, I mean, again, you can interrupt me at any point, but this was also a good stopping point. All right, so let's look at.
Sir, is this the only form of Eulenfest theorem?
Huh? Sorry?
Sir, is this the only form of this theorem?
The only form of Eulenfest theorem. Well, I'm not sure what you mean. Like, what other form would you like have in mind?
I mean, so here the expectation value momentum operator, it should be okay. Depend on somehow the momentum operator, right?
It depends on the momentum operator. Say that again. Priya, you're not. Can you say what you're trying to say again? Can you hear me, Priya?
Yes, sir. So am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. So go ahead. If you turn your video on, then I can also see your expressions.
So I think there's network issue from my side. That's why my voice is breaking.
There's network issue everywhere. Anyways, go on. What are you saying?
So I'm saying that I'm asking that the expectation value of that momentum operator is not depend on momentum operator itself. So is it possible? Like it should be depend on the operator itself. No? Like it is not. It's not seeing, sir, here. That's why I'm asking that, is there any other form of this theorem? It's not like we can't look at this theorem now, which is in the box. Explicitly, it is not present here. Maybe it...
What is not present?
The momentum operator.
So this is the momentum operator, right?
But sir, if we calculate the expectation value, the change in expectation value is not depending the operator involved.
No, it depends on the operator. No, I mean.
Like, sir, how we calculate from here?
Huh? So, how do you calculate an expectation value?
Sir, I'll...
Huh? No. Let me clarify all of that. Okay. Let's remind ourselves, right? What is an expectation value? The expectation value is this object, right? So it depends on some state. So this is, you are performing the measurement. So when you perform the measurement, you prepare your quantum system in some state, no? So the expectation value depends on the state of the system, right? Now, one point is, first of all, that this object, right, the expectation value of the momentum or the expectation value of any operator it gives us some information about the state, right? But it doesn't give us all the information, right? So how in what way, right? So imagine that you have again, let's talk about our Gaussian state, okay? So you have x and you have psi of x, okay? And psi of x is goes as e to the power minus x squared by alpha squared, right? But now I can also have a second state. Let's say I have a state which looks like this. Okay. And this is also, it's called that psi prime. It is also centered around the origin, okay? But it has a different width, a different spread, right? Now, if you ask what is the expectation value of the position operator in the first state, right? It is going to be equal to the expectation value of the position operator in the second state. Both of them will be zero, right? But these states are not the same, right? So how would you determine the differences between the state? So you might ask, well, what is the expectation value of x squared? So if you calculate the expectation value of x squared in the two states, right, what would you get? You would find that it is not the same. Okay. But even the expectation value of x squared doesn't give you the complete information about the state. You can calculate the expectation value of the nth power of the state. So this is called the nth moment, right? So if you want complete information, about the state or equivalently you can say or about a given operator, right? You need all the moments. Right, you need the expectation value of that operator. You need the expectation values of the square of the operator, of the cube of the operator, till some whatever, you know. In the real world, of course, you can stop at some finite n. And the thing is, that only the first one, it satisfies Newton's law, right? And when I say Newton's law, I mean Ehrenfest, in terms of Ehrenfest theorem, right? What about these other chaps? These don't. So we don't have anything like an Ehrenfest theorem for the higher moments. Okay, so Ehrenfest theorem doesn't tell us that a quantum state is the same as a classical state. It says that only some information about the classical state of about the classical origin of the state is present there in the quantum description. But the complete information about the quantum state is not there. So the all of the quantum effects are included in these higher moments, right? So for example, if you want to talk about the uncertainty, that is a quantum effect, that uncertainty is measured by the second moment, right? So, okay, I don't know to what extent this this satisfies your doubt. But I think the best way to satisfy your doubt will be to look at an example, okay? So when you work things out, things become clearer. So let's look at a harmonic oscillator. This is a classical. In the classical Hamiltonian, from this classical Hamiltonian, we can again use Hamilton's equations. And what we find is that x dot is, to nobody's surprise, just the momentum divided by the mass, which is just the velocity. And p dot is minus kx, which is the force, the restoring force. And so you get, if you combine both these equations, you get x dot is equal to minus k by m squared, right? And this is our equation of motion. Right, this is, now this is the classical harmonic oscillator. So let us look at the trajectories of this. Let's look at the solutions of this equation, right? So what are the solutions? The solutions are just combinations, linear combinations of sines and cosines, where omega is equal to the square root of k by m, right? And all, you can also write this in terms of exponentials, right? Complex exponential. But now c and d will be different from a and b. You can obviously express, so this is again your homework exercise, and it's a very simple one line exercise. C and D in terms of A and B. Okay, so these are your solutions, right? Now, what about the momentum? The momentum also has some time dependence, right? So the momentum, momentum is given by mx dot. We can just use this equation. So it's m times x dot t, right? It's just the time derivative with this. So what is the time derivative of that expression? You get minus am omega sine omega t plus b m omega cosine omega t, right? So this is pt, okay? And now what we can do is we can look at the solutions of the, we can ask, what do these trajectories look like in the phase space, right? So this Cartesian plane that I have drawn here, right? This is the phase space. And it's two dimensional because I have two degrees of freedom, the position and the momentum, right? Okay. Now for simplicity, what we will do, we can always make this choice. We set b is equal to zero. Right? We can do that by choosing a boundary condition. What is the boundary condition? We can say, so instead of b, should I set a equal to zero? So set a is equal to zero. We can do this by saying that at time t is equal to zero, the particle is at the origin. Okay, so if you put this condition in this expression, what do you get? At time t is equal to zero, well, this term is zero, the second term, because sine of zero is zero. This term is not zero, right? So for this condition to be true, A has to be zero, right? So this is our initial condition. So we get x of t is equal to b sine omega t, and p of t is equal to m omega b times cosine omega t. right? Now this is, if you look at this, this is the equation for what is called a parametric curve, right? It is a parametric curve. So as an example of a parametric curve, if you take x is equal to r cosine theta and y is equal to r sine theta, right? This is a parametric curve. What is the parameter? It's theta, right? And this curve is a circle. So we can see that if we take the square of x and the square of the momentum divided by m omega squared, right? What do we get? We get b squared, right? So now what I can do is, in my phase space, I rescale my momentum. Instead of taking a plot of with respect to p, I make a plot with respect to p by m omega, right? So, and what is this? This is the equation of a circle with radius b, right? Centered on the origin. So this is my trajectory. Right, it looks like a circle, and the radius of this circle is b. Right? Now, if you do not perform this rescaling, then what is the shape of this trajectory? It's an ellipse. Right? So if you don't rescale it, then the equation that you have, this is the equation of an ellipse, right? X squared by a squared plus y squared by b squared is equal to 1, right? And so it would look something like this. Right, so this is your trajectory. And as the system evolves, the point in the phase space moves along this ellipse. Right? So this is your classical equation of motion, classical picture. And then what happens if you increase or decrease the energy of the harmonic oscillator? Well, it will remain an ellipse, right? But the size of that ellipse will become either larger or smaller, depending on the energy that you choose to put into the system. Right, so E1 is going to be less than E2, is going to be less than E3, and this is a measure of the energy of the system, right? So again, this is a very, very simple exercise. Show that B squared measures the total energy of the oscillator. Okay? And the purpose of these exercises, by the way, for some of you, these exercises are trivial. You don't need to do anything. But there are probably many of you who are not able to follow everything that's going on. And the reason for that is because your background in these basic concepts is weak. So the purpose of these exercises for those of you who are having difficulty is to remind you of those basic concepts. Okay? So if you are feeling lost and confused, do these exercises that I give you. Okay? And you know, that is if you want to improve your state, if you want to go from a state of more confusion to a state of less confusion, then you should do this. All right, so this is a classical harmonic oscillator, and obviously we want to talk about the quantum harmonic oscillator. So what will be the quantum harmonic oscillator? Well, it will just be this operator p squared by 2m plus 1/2 kx squared, right? But now, so we want to find the states, right? In quantum mechanics, what do? We want to find the eigenstates. And eigenvalues of this Hamiltonian, right? So we'll do that next time. There are two ways to do it. One is the Dirac solution, and one is, you can call it the Schrodinger solution. The Dirac solution is very clever. It's an algebraic solution. The Schrodinger solution is a differential equation. We solve that differential equation in terms of something called Hermite polynomials. They both give you the same answer in the end of the day, but they both provide different insights into the problem. Okay? And then we will look at the time evolution of these states. And we will see that the time evolution of these states is very well described, has a similar description. Not exactly the same, but similar. Okay. All right, so I'll stop here and see if you have any questions. Otherwise, we can disperse and meet again at 3:30 for a class committee meeting. So, questions? Okay. All right then. See you all at 3:30. Bye bye.